Thanks again very much for joining me today.
Thanks for having me.
And so why don't we just start by you introducing yourself and your company a little bit for those, for the few of us who haven't heard about SentinelOne up until now.
I hope we don't have a lot of them, but so my name is Eran Ashkenazi. I'm SVP of Global Support and Services at SentinelOne. I actually joined SentinelOne about 6.5 years ago when the company was just over 10, maybe 15 people. We're about 650 employees worldwide today. Company has just finished its Series F valuation at just over $3 billion. We're a cybersecurity company. We cater B2B enterprise market, more so on the endpoint space, but a little bit also beyond that. And I think that like my journey with SentinelOne started in a place that I kind of asked Guy, where have your freemium model been 5 years ago? It could really have helped me. But you know, I started and I had different kind of path through customer success in the various growth stages of the organization. And you know, I'd be more than happy to talk a little bit about like some of the mistakes that we've done also, and how maybe Totango, mostly in the recent year or so since we've implemented it, helped us get into the next level of our expansion and growth.
Yeah, so we'll go one by one. Want to kind of, but thank you. This is very exciting. You know what you guys have been doing, and you know, congrats on all the success. So the question is, let's start with your personal journey in customer success. When did you formally define yourself as customer success, and what was your role prior to that?
So my employment history really goes back to technical roots, you know, back in like early 2000, starting as a solution engineer, QA engineer, and eventually as a professional services consultant. And I actually went through the ranks in a software company called Checkpoint Software Technologies, a firewall vendor, until I led the department before I joined SentinelOne. And in SentinelOne, I was still considering myself the professional services, the support head. And I think that it took a while until I figured out like that my role is really around the success of the customers, and owning the entire post-sales basically means that you need to really go way, way beyond the technical aspects of solving problems for your customers. And you need to go all the way back to the funnel, to collect those metrics and act on those metrics proactively.
Thanks. And what was the first charter that if we think about this, what was the first charter? Churn related? Was it happiness related? What was the first charter that you had for your new department of customer success?
So we have a customer success department. I have a director that is building that department. We have about 100 people in my organization, but 10 people like solely in customer success today. So we're health oriented, a lot of managed services, a lot of support. So this is the third iteration of our customer success. You said something about we're not going to get things right the first time. So yeah, I'm a living proof for that. But you know, when it started, I think initially it was like trying to cover everything everywhere. I think today we're a little bit more mature, both as managers and as a company. And the charter started with, I think in this iteration, in happy customers. And that's actually, you talked about OKRs. We have a top level OKRs, a company level OKR, which is happy customers. And everything that we do has to kind of eventually get us to the point that we're making our customers happy. Yes, I mean, there's NPS and churn and all sorts of other things, but that's the end goal for us.
So let's kind of, we are still talking about the first generation of customer success at SentinelOne. What was the first technology decision that you guys have made? How did you kind of bring it all together as a starting point?
Well, I mean, I had the luxury of kind of bringing in a lot of systems into SentinelOne, including our CRM, which is Salesforce, and our support system, which is Zendesk. And initially, I was slightly naive. I thought that I could actually make everything happen on Salesforce. And in fact, we've hired an external contractor firm. And, even back then we paid a couple of tens of thousands of dollars to start to glue in a bunch of pieces together. I'll get you to the end of that story. It didn't work. And it's really not worthwhile, in my opinion, to go that route. But again, I had to go through it. I had to, you know, make my mistakes for myself, I guess. And now I know.
And what is it, you know, what is it that, I guess, when you started, why did you think that, you know, the right approach would be, I'm assuming because Salesforce was there, you had familiarity with it, and you thought that, you know, customer success is a basic workflow of just telling people to follow up with customers from time to time, and that's how you run a program. Am I on the right track here?
Well, yes, Salesforce was there. To be honest, I kind of underestimated. I looked at a couple of platforms in the past. It was you and your large competitors, which obviously we didn't go with. And I thought to myself, what? You know, I could probably do this myself. It's just like, you know, just doing like a little bit of a red, green, yellow, and some tasks in Salesforce. But it's much, much more than that. And I think I was super naive and probably also young in my success career to understand what actually is needed. And you know, it's obviously changed.
Yeah, so this is like as a side note, both being Israelis, this is the classic selling technology for Israelis. You know, they all can build what you've built in 10 years, they can build in 10 days. Yeah. I've heard this many, many times before. All right, so let's kind of switch gears to the early success, right? So the next maturity level of customer success, SentinelOne is going through tremendous growth, and you need to deal with a new set of challenges. What were those challenges?
So we had a lot of obviously changes through the years, and not at all times I actually held exactly the same position. So there was a time that I kind of stepped away to build the managed service, and during that time there was someone else that led customer success. And you know, I think that there wasn't enough consistency there. The challenges that we've seen is that we just had more customers. So when I first built that little kind of flimsy thing on Salesforce, we had like 40, 50 customers. Couple of years, like 2 years later, we already had, let's say, hundreds or 1,000. Today, we have about 4,000+ customers. And I think that during that time where we started to scale, it was clear that we're not geared for that task. So we were still with those old systems. We had a bunch of like CSMs. And I think that there wasn't really a good, you know, not tool or process really to do what we're supposed to do. So it didn't really work, unfortunately.
So fast forward. So, you know, as I mentioned before, many, many companies go through kind of a scale of activity, whether it's because in your case, which was a good reason, more customers, but in other cases, it could be, you know, that once you open up digital channels, the volume that comes from the fire hose is so much higher. The volume is so much higher because you can't control the volume. But if we switch gears into, let's say, early mid stage, where you guys have decided that you're going to go with Totango as technology, can you talk about the first implementation? What was the scope of it, and how did you know that it's working? Right? What were you looking to prove out, and how did you know that you've proven it?
Yeah, it's a good point. I mean, we did like a proper POC. We looked at a couple of tools. It was Totango, Gainsight, Churn Zero, I think. And we really gave everyone a fair chance. But I think that at the end of the day, what we wanted is to make sure that we have very quick time to value. We're a growth startup. Everything runs super quickly. We don't have the ability to run through a project that goes through a year. I need to be able to show my CEO, the board, that within months of implementation, there's already results. So we thought.
There's a question in the Q&A. How long did the implementation take in your case?
So the implementation itself, I think that we started seeing things probably within the first couple of weeks. The thing about implementation and the definition of, it's probably super easy to get the tool to like 80% capacity within a very, very short period of time, like literally weeks. But those 20%, this is something that will take time. It's a lot of customization, bringing more data points, understanding all the flows. If you ask about success criteria, I think that once we brought the data, and then we just ran a couple of very basic anomaly reports, a couple of alerts of show me customers that are, you know, in our case, we have agents, endpoint agents, right? And show me customers that have, uninstalled X amount of agents in the last, 30 days, or And we started getting some alerts and we made some reach outs and we're already able to, you know, get in touch with customers before actually potentially they go during a, you know, a downhill or the wrong route. So I think that we already saw that benefit then and there, initial benefit at least.
Yeah, so you're saying creating you know, visibility and more specifically the risk detection as a use case. I mean, given that you guys are cybersecurity and what you do for a living is risk detection, I can see the similarities of why you decided to go with risk detection. But putting jokes aside, would you say that that created the first, let's say, step in confidence that allowed you to take the second step of the flywheel, right? That would be like a full cycle complete, and then based on that you had the confidence to keep going?
No, totally. Yeah, and I think that, you know, what happened for us is that actually when we implemented Totango, it created situations where we noticed we have data issues in other places. Because through the way that Totango consolidates the data, we noticed that we have data issues on Salesforce, and we have data issues on the way that we calculate the number of agents on our backend system. So, you know, it started a lot of side conversation and discussion, but once we got these things right, we're able to take also Totango from just being a customer success centric system to becoming a system that serves other departments in the organization. And, you know, I think that, you know, when I listened to your flywheel presentation, it was really talking about the fact that how a platform can kind of expand into other places. And this is like really containing that, you know, full cycle of the customer.
So, I mean, a lot of folks here in the audience who are kind of in customer success departments, I think we were kind of talking about a few things. We didn't make them very explicit, but I think the first implementation is, you know, around heroes, around rudimentary process, around, you know, technology that is just stitching the basics. We get this. And it seems that once you hit scale in business, you have to be systematic, predictable, and, you know, repeatable, where, you know, with changes, change cycles faster. So I think it's pretty clear that this is one of the benefits that you're getting from systematically implementing customer success block, right? In your case, risk detection. But I think a lot of folks in this audience are, you know, somewhat shy with the organization's reaction, mm-hmm, to investing in customer success, to kind of coming up with a statement that there's a better way to manage the journey and so forth. What was your experience? What tools did you have in order to be able to kind of from being quiet about what you're doing to put it very front and center in the organization? How did you fight it?
It's a great point, because I think that initially it was really that reaction of like, why do we need this? What is it? I mean, we have support. They could like do this, or, you know, and obviously there's a lot of education that needs to happen on the e-staff, on the C-suite, especially if there are people that are not coming from a proper kind of ARR SaaS models. And yes, I had to do a lot of that education, and it took me some time to get the budgets for tools, for people, for a head of the department. Some things that help, in my opinion, is to talk about, you know, especially, I mean, this is for renewable business, to talk really about like, where is that that bag of renewals? How does it look like next year? How does it look like in 2 years? And if you want to protect that, you know, next year or in 2 years from now, you have to start today. And this is what you need to do.
Great. We've got a lot of questions, and we're going to address them very shortly. But maybe one last topic on the flywheel before we kind of go to the Q&A. So what did you expand? You know, can you be specific? What were the expansion, you know, which other parts of the customer journey have you expanded into, and how did you collaborate with the teams that were the primary responsible for these parts of the journey?
Right. Yeah. You know, the other part is that I'm trying not to step on anyone's toes. Everyone likes their own little pond. But what I do is like, I want to bring the entire data set to be, unified and aligned between the organization. So, you know, the first thing, the easiest thing was to go to the renewals team. And the renewals team in our case is not part of the CS org. It's part of sales. and we got them engaged and we trained them and we showed them the light. And yes, they still work with Salesforce for their opportunities, but in fact, you know, they look into Totango on a daily basis, all of the renewal reps. And after we completed that part, that was kind of easy because it makes a lot of different, you know, amount of sense in the cycle. We actually went backwards in time. So we went to pre-sale and we told pre-sale, hey, you know, what about we bring those same, it's the same accounts. I mean, you know, it's what if we bring those accounts in an opportunity stage when they're in a technical POC and we provide the same insights that we have around usage, you know, product insights, et cetera. And you know, so far the feedback was very, very good. I mean, there needs to be some adjustments, but I think that it was very, very easy to convince the teams to use it. And for us, it's an easier transition. Pre-sale, we win a customer, it becomes a customer. It starts the life cycle of onboarding, et cetera. And we already have information on that customer. So we started early. That's good for us.
Yeah, and I would say that this the idea of Totango being system that orchestrates workflows or orchestrates data and not competing with existing system, it's on purpose because I think they serve different purposes, right? You have the system of records, which are owned by the department, but then you have the orchestration that orchestrate the entire customer journey, and they work in concert. All right, this is a great story. I'm sure there's so much more, and you know, Eran, if you don't mind, at the end you can share with others your contact information so they can follow up with you directly.
Sure.
If you wish. I know that you're here.
Yeah, I'm pretty responsive.
We've got 6 minutes, so let's knock some very, very, very simple questions, and then do some more difficult ones. So, what data was the most difficult to import?
So, for us, the data that was the most difficult to import was actually product data, because there's some existing connectors, so it's pretty easy to connect with Zendesk, with Salesforce, with some other tools. Our product data is like, you know, hived in various levels, but what helped us in that case is instead of trying to create this crazy connector, we basically use an existing capability that Totango has, which is basically to, take directly files like, you know, CSV, XML files from an S3 bucket. So it was pretty easy to just paste all that data in the S3 bucket. And on a daily basis, Totango grabs the information and automatically populates and aligns the field. Another very important thing that we've done, and I actually did it unpurposely, like way back in the day, was to make sure that I use a single identifier across all my data points. And what I did is I used the ID, and that in everything. It's the contract, the data on our cloud, it's the data on our product, et cetera. And we bring all of that together, even on Zendesk support, we bring all of that together. And then Totango easily correlates the data based on that unique key.
Yeah, that's one of those early ideas of how do you integrate data. What do you suggest to someone who is just starting to build customer success in an organization from scratch? I guess the question is, what do you suggest from technology? What do you suggest from how to set it up? The people side of the equation.
Right. I mean, it really depends on the organization. I think that starting with a tool early in the game is easier than trying to implement it later down the road when you have hundreds or thousands of customers. And I didn't say it for nothing. If I had a freemium option like 5-6 years ago, I would take that. And more than likely, I would be a Totango customer, because I would already be customized to the tool. But of course, the option didn't exist there. So I would say definitely go with the freemium model. I mean, worst case, don't use it. I mean, if it's not good for you, right? So it's easy to understand and validate what it is. I think that it's good for small teams that are just starting. Make sure that you, if you're not considering yourself a proper, I would say, a seasoned manager in the world of customer success, make sure that that first person that you bring to the team is a real leader that can also get their hand dirty. It's not just related to customer success, but some mistakes I've done in the past is that I was trying to be cheap, small company, not a lot of funds, and trying to bring like someone that used to be a team lead somewhere into a director role and things like that. And honestly, it doesn't really work. Like it works initially, but then it doesn't scale. So invest in the right people and definitely use whatever tools, especially if they're free initially, to start the road.
Yeah, so you're saying invest in best-in-class people and best-in-class technology. I 100% agree with you with that. although I do have an angle here. There's another question. How much resources from your end was required to implement? And if you can also answer, there's a follow-up question is, you know, when was it? When did you start with Totango?
Yeah, so I mean, I've started doing POCs probably in like summer 2019. And, you know, we hired our director of customer success in September. In fact, I already made a decision by then. But, you know, for all things to look well, I did allow him, you know, that person to make the decision. And he made exactly the same decision that I did. And at that point, actually, the implementation process was that head of customer success that we brought in. And pretty much, I would say, a couple of hours a week of a product manager that helped us correlate things on the you know, data gathering side, on our product side. And the folks from Totango, we did take professional services package to kind of like help us get there on the road quickly, but it wasn't painful, really. It was pretty smoother than I thought it would be, actually.
Our goal is, you know, we understand customer success a little bit, and our goal is to get customers have, you know, great first time experience. So hopefully I'm happy that you got this. Eran, thank you very, very much for sharing your experience in the customer success flywheel. It's really impressive the speed in which you've been able to implement with only 1 year from detecting risk to renewal to pre-sales to customer success. All of that is great. Please look Eran up in the Brella app. I'm there too. Yep. Happy to share more information. Thank you all, and have a great rest of the conference. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Guy. Thank you guys for listening.
Thank you very much, Guy and Eran, for sharing your experience through this session. It's great having you at the conference. To our lovely audience, as Guy mentioned, if you would like to find any of the speakers or network with them, head over to Brella, find the session, find the speakers, and feel free to connect to them. And I would say that that's it. We are at the end of day two of the customer conference for CS Value Stream. At this moment, actually, there is a closing keynote session that is starting at the Thought Leadership Track. So head over there not to miss it out. Thank you for being with us over the last 2 days. And thank you to Congress Geeks and Customer Success Network for putting up such an amazing event. Hope to see you all next year. Bye.